I'm hopeful.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks for trying to make me feel better.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Good time.
Is this excise tax new?
I know, I don't know if you'd like to plug in your binder.
Oh.
Something, I don't know. Yeah, exactly.
All right, well, good evening, everyone. We are after 7, so in order to keep things moving, I'd like to call the Tuesday, May 24th, 2016 Planning Commission meeting to order. If everyone would please rise and state the Pledge of Allegiance with me. Okay, we'll now move into roll call, starting on my right.
Barber here.
Mater here.
Limer here.
Lavella here.
Austin here.
Quorum is present. Moving into the consent agenda, all matters listed within the consent agenda have been distributed to each member of the Planning Commission for study. These items are considered to be routine and will be enacted upon by one motion with no separate discussion. If separate discussion is desired on an item from either the Planning Commission or from the floor, that item may be removed from the consent agenda and placed on the regular agenda. Is there any item any member of the commission would like to have removed from the consent agenda?
Yes. I move that on the minutes from the April 26, 2016 meeting, it's titled Special Planning Commission Meeting. We need the word special removed.
Okay, great. We'll go ahead and remove that. Are there any items any member of the public would like to have removed from the consent agenda? Seeing none from the public, I'd entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda with the exception of item number 1, with that motion being made by Commissioner Lavella. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 All those opposed? Motion carries with all in favor to remove item number 1 for discussion, which I believe, per Commissioner Lavella, we need to have the minutes of the Tuesday, April 26, 2016 Planning Commission meeting. The word special be struck and changed to regular. If I got that correct?
Yep.
Okay. if everyone is in agreeance with that and there's no other items that need to be pulled for discussion, I would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda item number one with the change made by Commissioner Lavella. Someone would like to make that motion.
I move to approve the consent agenda with the revision to item number one made by Commissioner Lavella.
Second.
We have a motion made by Austin with a second by Barber that we change the consent agenda item number one as stated by Commissioner Lavella. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carries with all in favor. Moving on to the regular agenda, we have item number one, comprehensive plan amendment. Reconsider the adoption of a comprehensive plan amendment, which includes the adoption and incorporation by reference of the I-35 and Gardner Road Interchange Subarea Plan by Planning Commission Resolution PC-16-06, if appropriate. This was sent back for reconsideration by the governing body on May 2nd, 2016. So we have a staff presentation this evening. Great.
Good evening, Commissioners. As you know, this is a comprehensive plan amendment and also the adoption of the I-35 and Gardner Road Interchange Subarea Plan. This item was first considered by the Planning Commission January 26th, and at that time you adopted the subarea and comp plan text changes after a public hearing, and that was by Resolution PC-1601. In February, the governing body considered this plan for the first time, and they heard from some concerned property owners regarding the future land use designations, and so they tabled the item to allow for additional contact with those concerned property owners. And so those meetings took place as detailed in your staff report. And then in May, the governing body voted to return the item for your consideration regarding comments from information received from these three specific property owners. So this is just a kind of an orientation map here of the properties that we're discussing, or at least that the property owners own. The number one is up in the top right, number two in the bottom left, and then number three is the red triangle in the middle. And we'll cover those in order. Property number one, the owner is Fraley, and and this property lies in the city of Gardner at this time. It's between the terminus of Highview Drive and I-35. In the plan, it shows there could be a future road connection through the neighborhoods, or it could be collector frontage road along I-35 extending from 188th or 183rd. So that's just to kind of orient you to the context of that property. This slide shows you the designation of the property in the current comprehensive plan, and it's just the photo on the right is the current zoning. The property is recommended in the subarea plan or in the comprehensive plan as low density residential. When the property was originally annexed into Gardner, however, the C3 zoning was established, and that is the current zoning of the property. Adjacent properties that are in the county are zoned rural agricultural uses with a 10-acre minimum and with single family, and also single family dwellings with a 1-acre minimum. The adjacent city zoning is R1, which is single family, R2 duplex, and C3 commercial. So based on the owner's future vision for this property and expressed resistance to a zoning change in the future, a future land use designation of commercial could be appropriate. The community commercial future land use that comes from the comprehensive plan, however, would accommodate the smaller commercial nodes that are intended to meet the needs of residents within and adjacent to neighborhoods. So that would be the community commercial future land use designation. This would seem the most appropriate category for that context. So if the Planning Commission should decide to accommodate a change designation, that's the one that staff would recommend. Property owner number two is Baker. This property lies outside the city limits currently between 199th and I-35. This property is not addressed in the comprehensive plan, but its current zoning is RUR, which is rural agricultural use in the county, again, with single-family dwellings of a 10-acre minimum lot size. So the current owner of this property envisions this property possibly being used in the future for an RV park or other commercial use on the portion that's adjacent to I-35. And then he envisions residential for the balance of the property. The subarea plan future land use draft designation is low density residential. So once this property would be annexed into the city, the applicant, I think, would be able to implement various mechanisms to achieve his vision. He might be able to use a planned zoning district where you can combine a master plan development scenario. Also, as proposed in land development code, RV parks and campgrounds are drafted as conditional uses in the ag district, which is actually consistent with current zoning. And then on top of that, he would have a future land use designation of residential, which would allow him to achieve that portion of the development. So with these considerations, a change in future land use designation to partially commercial is not recommended from staff, just based on the context, including environmental considerations. There's quite a bit of floodplain on the property. And if it was designated as commercial and then later zoned commercial, there would be a wide variety of uses that would be accommodated there, you know, other than an RV park or campground. The third property owners are Long. This is designated with the number 3 in this slide. This property lies inside the city limits. The owner, I think, right at this point is concerned about the property adjacent to their property to the north and the future land use designation of that property. Two of those parcels are outside city limits. These are ones I think they're concerned with that are inside the city limits, and then there's a couple over here that are outside the city limits at this time. The owner's property, which is, again, in the triangular shape there, and the adjacent property to the north is identified as regional commercial on the eastern portion and intermodal industrial on the west in the comprehensive plan, or at least in some of the industrial plans and commercial plans of the comprehensive plan. The owner's property is designated as regional commercial in the subarea plan consistent with their request. The adjacent property to the north is currently designated as light industrial and regional commercial in the subarea plan. And that the Plan Commission's discussion previously was that light industrial provided a transition between the heavy industrial to the west and the commercial to the east. The current zoning of the properties that are outside the city is, again, rural agricultural with single-family dwellings of various lot sizes. The current zoning of the properties inside the city is C2 and C3. So the Planning Commission did previously consider this requested change in future land use designation of property across from this property owner and decided to maintain the designations as drafted. Staff concurs with the currently drafted designation for the purpose of focusing that commercial node around that intersection, promoting diverse uses in the community, and providing a rational transition of uses. Per the Land Development Code, the use regulations of the equivalent zoning district should be complementary to the potential uses on the property to the south, and there are ample buffer requirements to help ensure the compatibility of those districts. So this is just a recap. So that property number one, the current owner desired this future land use designation of current of commercial to reflect current zoning. And the comprehensive plan designates the community commercial future land use for areas that consist of smaller commercial nodes intended to meet the needs of residents, generally located within or adjacent to neighborhoods that may consist of standalone structures or small shopping centers with multiple commercial uses. This is the commercial land use that is more consistent with the location and the description rather than the regional commercial land use that's designated around the 191st interchange. The current property owner of property number two desires a future land use designation of both commercial and residential to accommodate his future vision of RV park and residential. Staff advises accomplishing this through other mechanisms through the new land development code, as discussed previously. And again, the desires of the current property owner adjacent to property number three have actually not been expressed. But the owner of property number three requires a future land use designation of commercial for the adjacent property to the north, and staff is supporting keeping the light industrial designation for that area. If you are going to follow up with a change in designation for property number one, the Fraley property, you would need to also make a change in the subarea plan to add that community commercial future land use category as shown. And that would be that property. This would show the changed map if you do change the designation of the property. The red would be the community commercial. You can see that there's medium density residential and single family residential surrounding it, and then there would be regional commercial further south. And here's our recommendation. Staff recommends the Planning Commission reconsider PC 1601, which adopted amendments to the Gardner Comprehensive Plan, which incorporates by reference the I-35 and Gardner Road Interchange Subarea Plan based on the direction of the governing body, and adopt PC Resolution 1602, Comprehensive Plan Amendment, including the adoption and incorporation by reference of the I-35 and Gardner Road Interchange Subarea Plan with the following changes. Change the Vernon Fraley property to be identified on Map 3-1 from low-density residential to community commercial, and add the land use category to section 3.3.1 for the community commercial land use. And then recommend forwarding a recommendation for approval to the governing body. All right, that's great. All I have.
Okay.
Do you have any questions? Or?
Do you want our questions?
I don't think we have any questions from...
Do you want our questions?
Let's maybe hold off on any questions in case... While this is not a public hearing item, we do have several members in the audience who may want to come up and make a public comment regarding this item. So we'll entertain a quick time of public comment. So with that said, if anyone would like to comment on this item, please come forward and state your name and address for the public record. Individuals will be allotted about 3 minutes, or an individual representing a group will be allotted about 7 minutes.
Madam Chairman, Lyle Pishney, would it be possible to ask the staff to put the colored map back up with the three
Absolutely.
Different tracks?
Yeah, that would be just fine. Thank you.
Okay. So I thought I might just articulate a little bit more of the concerns that property owner 3 expressed to staff. The owners of property 3 were requested to meet with staff subsequent to the city council's remand to this body. So the family did meet with Larry Powell and Cheryl Harrison Lee at their request to express concerns. At that meeting, some of the issues that Kelly articulated were mentioned and a few others, and a commitment was made to get back to the property owners regarding staff's consideration of the various issues in anticipation of this meeting. I might just point out that the family, the property owner, never did hear back from staff. Today, on the eve of the meeting, reached out to Michelle Leiniger, who'd been a point of contact, reached out to Cheryl and to Larry, found out all 3 were absent from the office this week, and of course there had been no communication in the interim. So as a matter of process, I would point that out to this body, that if you're going to have staff meet with residents or property owners and a commitment is made to get back to them and communicate with them, there probably needs to be some process in place to ensure that that occurs, because just for your knowledge and awareness, that's not occurring. The points that we'd made in part previously and we made to staff as the owners of Property 3 are the abutting uses to the north. This body did at its last meeting change the designation of the property immediately north and to the west of Property 3 from heavy industrial to light industrial, which we felt was a good and important improvement of the plan. We did articulate our continued concern that immediately to the northwest you show heavy industrial, and this is, as we remarked before, is designed as a corridor into the city, and we think heavy industrial would contemplate freight terminals, rail yards, salvage yards, and similar uses is really not compatible with this usage into the city in this corridor. Your zoning and planning codes, as we pointed out before, contemplate transitional uses, and as you'll see on the map, the result of this plan that is proposed to be adopted has this heavy industrial abutting what is on your map, medium density residential, high density residential, and commercial. Your code does contemplate transition uses, and a transition from commercial is commercial to light industrial or a business office park. Juxtaposing heavy industrial against commercial and multiple residential classifications seems a very odd planning result and doesn't seem contemplated by or consistent with your code. These concerns have all been expressed to staff, and for whatever reason, the dialogue stopped at that point, and we've been ready, willing, and able, and anxious to visit with the city about these issues and concerns. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The property was referred to as the Long family property. The property is actually the Radke family property. The Long family is a member of the family.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. We don't have any other members of the public to address the commission on this item. I think we'll go ahead and
move that we
We didn't have a public hearing.
Oh, that's right.
That was just comments.
That's right.
So now we can have discussion. This is our turn for questions and comments of staff. We did hear from one concerned citizen, so if there's any questions or comments that we would like to direct to staff on that, we can. This is our time for questions.
Okay. Yes, I have at least one question, or maybe a couple. The addition of the community commercial verbiage or option for the type of land use, is this going to be the only piece of land in the entire document that uses the community commercial? And if so, is it, I guess, what's the reasoning for adding a whole new category for this one lot of land?
The community commercial is contained in the comprehensive plan, and the subarea plan is also incorporated by reference to that comprehensive plan, so it won't be the only property in the whole plan that is decided, but that doesn't mean that, but it would be the only one in the single subarea plan, and then we do have the other subarea plan.
Okay. And then the map on page 3-7 appears to be the the old map, and then 3-8 would be the new map reflecting that change. Should they both still be included in here, or somehow labeled differently?
Okay, so are you looking at the revised plan, or the one that's about to be
revised?
Okay.
I think.
I think that it is intended that
Does that answer your question, Brad?
Yes, it did. Thank you.
Do you have any others?
No, I think, I guess, addressing the comment from the public regarding that area up, the heavy industrial that abuts the medium density and the high density residential there on the west side, I do agree that that appears strange. However, I also acknowledge that that's the intermodal facility that's currently in Edgerton's city limits, abutting that space. And so I'm not sure that there's developmental ways around that becoming heavy industrial. That, I guess, that would be my thought process on that line going up through there, just based on where I think the intermodal facility is moving towards. Don't know that we can get around that. And also, the folks from staff who spoke to the citizens who aren't here tonight, I would, you know, obviously like to express our concern, I guess, to make sure that they are following up when they say they're going to be following up, and that we can look into that one when those folks get back.
Okay. Aaron, you have anything? Brett?
Possibly. I was kind of echoing some of Brad's comments. Is any member of staff tonight able to lend any knowledge to attempted or lack thereof of communication since the agreement to continue communication?
Simply, I have no knowledge.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Not immediately. I'm going to look at something back.
Absolutely. Sherry?
No.
No.
Thank you.
that. Well, I think just maybe a quick question for staff, and maybe it would help to have the rest of the commissioners and the folks in attendance tonight just maybe understand that we are going through a completely new code rewrite. That's item number two on the agenda. And is there anything different within the light industrial designation versus the commercial designation that perhaps, since we have Chris with us tonight, and you know, Kelly, you're here too, but I mean, is there per se a huge difference to where it's just the light industrial should not be there, that it's a huge detriment to having the light industrial? Because, you know, our last conversation when we had the meeting, it seemed like it was a good transition. And knowing now what we understand through the code update and kind of how the different classifications will work, I mean, is there any, you know, concern or perhaps maybe a reassurance that could be quickly discussed that this is not a huge detriment to having the light industrial designation there instead of the commercial?
Code update itself, I can say, and I'm going to cover that in item number two. The zoning districts that were drawn up to implement those land categories aren't changing the inputs at all. The uses are all comparable to the new approaches to the work goals. The building types and landscape site development standards are all comparable, if not the same. Some of the new approaches might seem to change here and there, but there won't be any real significant impact on things that were zoned in one before, that were zoned in one after, and things that are going to be before, and after. The focus of our changes is on some of the other concepts in your conference.
Okay.
Your comments kind of hit on where I was headed regarding the M1s and M2s. So
okay.
You took care of that. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Well, if there's no other questions or comments, I would entertain a motion on this item.
I'd like to move Planning Commission adopt Resolution PC 1602, Comprehensive Plan Amendment, which includes the adoption of the changes to the comprehensive plan and the incorporation by reference of the I-35 and Gardner Road Interchange Subarea Plan with the following changes. Change the Vernon Fraley property to be identified on Map 3-1 from low-density residential to community commercial land use. Number two, add the land use category to Section 3.3.1 of the land use descriptions for the community commercial land use, and recommend forwarding recommendation for approval to the governing body.
Second.
We have a motion made by Limer with a second by Barber that Planning Commission adopt Planning Commission Resolution PC-16-02, a comprehensive plan amendment, which, hold on a minute, yeah, which incorporates, sorry, I got that wrong, which includes the adoption of the changes to the comprehensive plan and the incorporation by reference of the I-35 and Gardner Road Interchange Subarea Plan with the following changes. One, change the Vernon Fraley property to be identified on Map 3-1 from low-density residential to community commercial land use. And two, add the land use category to Section 3.3.1, land use descriptions for the community commercial land use, and forward a recommendation for approval to the governing body. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 All those opposed? Motion carries with all in favor.
Madam Chairman, I did abstain since I missed the staff presentation.
Great, thank you.
Please make note.
Thank you. Moving on to new business item number two. Just the regular agenda, business item number two. Text amendment, land development code. Consider and hold a public hearing on a text amendment to repeal the existing Gardner City Code, Title 17, Subdivision Regulations, and Title 18, Zoning, and replace the proposed Title 17, Land Development Code. Do we have a staff presentation for this evening?
Good
We are here tonight to view and discuss the draft land development code, which is a document that combines the city's subdivision and zoning regulations and the design standards into one very elegant document that helps bring to life the vision of the community's adopted plans. This document is very exciting for me from an urban design perspective. I think it's really going to enable the creation of distinctive and well-integrated places as Gardner grows. And with the assistance of staff, developers will be guided through illustrated options for open space, building, frontage, and street types, which, when woven together, will help ensure a more sustainable, people-friendly, and economically enduring framework for development. I guess you can tell I'm a fan of the code, and I think Gardner is definitely headed in the right direction here. Staff has prepared a summary for the Planning Commission, including a background history of the project, a few of the many ways that the code is consistent with community plans, and a high-level summary of the regulatory change. That's in your staff report. From that staff report, we offer just the following general recommendation: that after exploration of the discussion topics with the advisory committees and with members of the public, and a careful and comprehensive interdepartmental review by city staff and the Planning Commission, staff recommends approval of the final draft of the Land Development Code as presented, subject to any final non-substantive changes in formatting and text. So at this time, what I'd really like to do is introduce our project partner, Chris Brewster of Gould Evans, who I think has the patience of a saint working with all of us, but he will provide some real insight into this process that we have gone through and the purpose behind the code and introduce the finer details of the code to you and to interested members of the public.
Thank you.
Good evening. Chris Brewster, Gould Evans, 4041 Mill Street in Kansas City, Missouri. First, I'd like to thank the planning commissioners and staff for putting in as much time as you have, especially over the last couple months. It makes our job a lot easier, and we definitely appreciate all of the time and the details and the reviews and direction that's given to us. We love it on projects when the community takes ownership and it's your document, not ours. We feel that leads to the best results. I did want to just go through and go back to a little bit of the history to cover where we've been on this. When we were first hired, these were the project directives and objectives. First, implement your recently adopted comprehensive plan. Improve the development review process, make it more streamlined and raise people's expectations. Have a more user-friendly code. It's always a goal when we get involved in projects like this. Your regulations get amended over time. Things become disjointed and sections don't work well together. And so that was a major goal of the project. Align with the economic development strategy that was also developed in conjunction with your comprehensive plan in 2014. And promote the council's strategic goals as well. So those were our marching orders, so to speak. A little bit about our approach and philosophy towards regulations. The first thing we do is try to give a logical framework and structure. That we kind of take a real hard look at the table of contents and the subsections and take that seriously, because we know the code's not going to be perfect and it's going to be amended over time, hopefully not immediately, but you're going to come across things that you need to change, and so we want that logical framework and structure to guide all of that so you don't quickly get into the same problems you had before adoption of the code. So we're hopeful that that's really helpful to you all as you continue to use it. We add purpose and intent statements through all of the zoning districts and all of the standards and subsections so that we're constantly reminded of why a standard's in place and what its link is to the city's policies and plans. So that anytime there's an interpretation or anytime you're being asked to grant flexibility, that should help guide you. We strive for a plain language approach, understanding that, yes, it's a legal document that may have to be defended at times, but we also know these codes are constantly encountered by citizens, people in the design and development community, lay people, so they don't necessarily have to be written for experts and specialists, and so we strive to do that wherever we can. Use of graphics and tables to help explain concepts and ideas. Flexibility plus expectations. One of the things we always hear, especially from the development community, and we heard that on this project, is you know, if they just tell us what the standards are, we'll be happy. And at the same time, if they just give me flexibility so I can do what we want, we'll be happy. And there's those two statements aren't necessarily directly opposed to each other. We feel it through the decision-making criteria, you have an appropriate level of discretion and flexibility to deal with things that you don't always expect. But we also want people's expectations, both citizens and developers, to be raised coming into this process. And then the last part, your plan very much talks about different contexts in your community where completely different standards are going to be appropriate. And so that kind of aligns with our overall philosophy towards regulations, that we skew less from the pure land use approach and more towards some of the urban design elements that Kelly was referencing. Our overall process, over a year ago when we kicked it off, we had our project schedule targeting this for March. We're only a couple months off, which actually isn't too bad. We often run longer, and we're prepared to run longer because, as you know, we get into some details that take some time to talk about. But we stayed pretty much to this and went through all of the six phases as we evolved the project. The engagement strategy initiation here in this public meeting, these are all the public events back in this room in March of 2015. We had two public open houses, one in April of 2015 to talk about to kick off the project and talk about general issues with the community and get a feel for what kind of things beyond the plan that they felt need to be implemented. And then we also had a public open house here in October about talking about our discussion papers, which were focused on specific topics. An advisory committee made up of a few planning commissioners, a few BZA members, and members of the development community met five times over the course of March through February, mainly dealing with those issues and issue papers, and then helping us steer the initial draft of the document. We met at the Gardner Rotary Club in December to present some of the progress on the project. The technical committee, which was mainly staff, we had six meetings mainly dealing with the initial and final drafts and taking some of the direction from you all. And then, of course, the Planning Commission's work over the last few months on several work sessions where we addressed some of the articles in detail, which brought us to tonight's public hearing. Again, back to some of the major driving things. This is the economic development strategy from 2014, and those are the five main themes in that plan. A friendly business climate, quality community, strengthening downtown, business retention and expansion, and business development. And like many communities doing economic development strategies, this strategy is very heavy in placemaking elements, particularly quality community and downtown. The idea of places and experiences for people being valuable to development and valuable to the city in general and valuable to property owners is very strong throughout that economic development strategy, which is one of the things we tried to integrate into the development code as well. The comprehensive plan themes, these are the seven main themes of the plan, improving on the housing variety that's in your community, local employment growth, image and identity was a very strong element of the plan, capitalizing on your regional transportation assets, fiscal sustainability, strong city center, again, downtown, and then green connections. Those are the main themes driving that 2014 plan. From that, we did our analysis of your current code, and this is just a snapshot of that document that we provided in the early phases of the project, where we went through section by section and actually rated each section against some of those themes. They're going across the top, the major headings, and then some of the subheadings. And so that gave us an idea of where your code was strong or weak versus some of those ideas and pointed us in some directions on things we needed to improve. The issue papers that I mentioned earlier, where we had the open house on, we landed on these six topics where we explored and brainstormed some ideas a little further. How do we deal with housing variety? How do we strengthen downtown? What types of open spaces are we planning for? Streetscapes and specifically street trees. How do we, you know, do all the things we want to do in the limited space of the right-of-way? Signs, always a troublesome issue on regulations for communities, and then temporary uses. And those issue papers were used to kind of just discuss ideas before we'd even begun drafting the code and figure out where the community landed on being more progressive or aggressive on standards regarding that, or more conservative, and or were you exploring a range of options and those types of things. And so that those, again, helped us, one, talk with the public about these topics, and then, two, land on a direction from you all as well. Just to dive into the code a little bit, the reorganization of it, going down the left side, or and I know it's hard to read, but all of the existing sections, and the point of that is, one, it's not too well organized. The subdivision regulations and the zoning ordinance are really kind of just a collection of standards. They're not a well-integrated product right now. And the other point of this is everything that's in there that was currently working and being used well is in the new code as well. So we were able to transfer everything over and just reorganize, eliminate a lot of redundancy, to be honest with you, from sections to sections. And you know, that's all part of the streamlining effort, but organize it into 10 main articles. Some of the more technical and routine things, the streamlining and user-friendliness, Article 3 is where we focus a lot of our efforts on simplified common procedures. So things that were common across all procedures we tried to organize, and you know, there's a table of applications to help people kind of get a handle for what process they're going into, what notice requirements are going to be required with certain applications and those types of things. And so getting that all in one place, they were scattered throughout the development regulations and sometimes addressed in more than one place, which creates conflicts, and that's never good on the things that are procedural. And so getting those all in one section and getting them much better organized was the main part of Article 3. And then throughout the code, intent statements, which I mentioned earlier, you know, some of those things that tie standards to the policies and help you interpret it. And then with the procedures, the decision-making criteria, with each application, we're giving both applicants and people that make decisions on these some of the things to use as your checkpoints, basically, in approval or denial of applications. Article 5, dealing with the zoning district and specifically land uses, your current districts had, for lack of a better term, kind of laundry lists of uses, and so we did a comparison of all of the land uses, and those were some of the questions you had before about, you know, what are the differences before and after, and they're not really that significant, other than we tried to eliminate those things that are, they're kind of at once too specific and too general. When you think of it, your retail uses is a good example. You'd have long lists of all kinds of uses that, you know, there wasn't really a difference between any of them, so we tried to generalize those into retail as a general category, but then also talk about what you really care about within your zoning districts are the scale of those uses and the impact it might have on your infrastructure and surrounding areas. And so we reoriented a lot of the uses to more general approaches, but then categorized them based on the scale and intensity of uses so that you can peg them to the appropriate zoning districts. We did a more targeted approach to plan districts, which it's often common that communities use the idea of plan zoning that as an idea of, well, that's how we give flexibility. You can change every zoning district to a plan district, and then that plan can, in fact, become the standards. And so we tried to approach that differently, you know, and not do those types of districts just at a site level, but to change the site plan process for when you're giving flexibility. But if you're doing plan districts, to really be things that are master planned on a larger scale, where they're actually influencing development patterns, street patterns, civic spaces, those types of things, where the master plan can really drive a different product than what we anticipated in the code. And so we set up that the procedures in those districts to really allow that to happen. That was something we talked about with the advisory committee quite a bit, particularly the residential developers, on how to improve that process and give them flexibility when it's warranted, but then not just let it be used at a site plan level to just for someone who just doesn't want to meet your standards. And then the tables and graphics used throughout was another streamlining and user-friendly element. The enable the plan portion of this, this is where, as Kelly mentioned, this is where the most different and, I guess, new approaches, things that will be a little bit out of the box than the conventional approaches to development regulations. But, again, going back to both the economic development strategy and your comprehensive plan, there is a real heavy emphasis on community image, placemaking, kind of raising the bar for those types of things. And so our approach was that's driven by your public realm first and foremost. You know, your design of your public spaces does more to influence how your community is perceived and how people experience it, more so than any element that you'll regulate from the development side will. So we started there by looking at street networks and street design types. From there, the extension of that are the open spaces and civic space systems. And from then, we talk about how does development relate to it? What are the building types and frontage types that make sense in those different contexts? And then across the board, your plan sets up very well. Things from out in your growth areas where you'd be entertaining more rural or green or open space type design, all the way down to things in your downtown, which are very compact, walkable, and the neighborhoods around that. So it's very much context driven as well. And so those tools give you the flexibility to have the right standards in the right place. So the way we think about that is, one, you're establishing the public realm with the street networks and street types. Two, you're enhancing it with extensions of that through open spaces, whether they be private open spaces or public open spaces. Again, and another element of the trail system and the trail master plan, that's a very strong part of your plan. You know, tying into that through both public and private elements was very strong. And then third, then it makes sense to say, okay, now let's write up some development standards that relate to that public realm. Walk through a little bit of the specifics of that. So street types, and in fact, this is one we had ongoing discussions, but even continued discussions today with Public Works and Engineering on this, on getting this geared right to their city's, their street specifications. But the standard type is the one where it's just that's the business as usual. That's the status quo suburban style streets that are geared towards moving traffic. However, your comprehensive plan talks about three other important contexts, and one is the activity center, places where you want more pedestrian activity, be it here downtown or new emerging commercial centers. They require a dramatically different street type, and so things that allow on-street parking, things that have much wider sidewalks and landscape and streetscape amenities in them, and so that's the activity street. The neighborhood street was one that that has a more tamer traffic profile than what your standard suburban street has. And so things that, you know, encourage and allow large street trees. You have examples of that throughout your community, yet your standards didn't really reinforce that. So we wanted to enable that. And then the last one are the green streets, things that have a more environmentally sensitive profile, things that might incorporate natural runoff or more a more rustic landscape element, not as refined or profile or formal to it. We would see that being used in a lot of the residential subdivisions that your plan called for out in the new growth areas, the idea of conservation subdivisions where you could cluster housing in exchange for large open spaces. Perhaps even streets that go along with your trail system would use those types of profiles as well. So that's what we did with the street types. Most communities have, going across the top of that table, are what you typically plan and design with, arterial, local, and collector streets, and all the standards are the same. So what we wanted to do was to take these design elements and overlay them onto those functional classes and give you the ability to influence the street design based on different contexts. And here's just a few examples of each of those different street types and the different character that they can create for areas of the community. The second element, enhance the public realm, the open space and civic space systems. Again, a very similar idea that codes often deal with open space as a quantity, you know, 10%, 15%, What's the right number? Well, the right number depends on what's your context and what are you trying to do with that open space. Is it used for natural or ecological aspects? Is it used for screening and buffering? Is it used for recreation, or is it used for more formal and civic gathering? And so we wanted to give you the whole range of open spaces that you use in different contexts, from the walkable and compact areas to things that are just generally applicable to throughout the community, to the other types that are supporting more suburban or open areas of your community. And just a few examples of the different types of open space and how they can support and enhance development projects as well. And then the last approach was then getting to the building types, looking at what development standards go along with that context that you're creating through the public realm. So this is just the residential building types. Again, the housing choices theme was very strong in your plan. In fact, probably the strongest element of your plan was that idea of preparing for demographic changes, preparing for lifestyle changes, different market needs that are coming our way in the metropolitan area. And what we find in development codes is they're good at going from single family to perhaps duplex, and then it jumps up to this ambiguous category called multifamily, and everything's just the same and we regulate by density. But there's really this whole broad range of housing types in that area that some may be appropriate in some contexts and some not, and that's what we found with your code. The multifamily, a good example, the multifamily zoning district wasn't very appropriate for doing some strategic infill in and around downtown here. And so a building type approach made a lot of sense specifically for this area. When we started exploring that idea more and looking at the other residential districts, we decided, well, there's some merit to actually approaching all of the residential districts and, in fact, all of the zoning districts with this idea of building types rather than just district-wide standards. And so going down the left of that screen are what zoning districts different building types would be allowed in, again, refining it to specific contexts. So what does that mean to your current zoning districts and development standards? Well, what we were able to do was to say, you know, most of the existing building types are maintained. Again, the single family and homes all maintained, the garden apartment and the duplexes all maintained. What we did was we added these new, what's kind of called the missing middle, those small scale but compact housing types that actually might have quite high densities, but because they're in very small scale buildings, they fit in to these places where you want to encourage more people to be in your community, whether it's neighborhoods in and around downtown or whether it's a new mixed-use center that could allow some of these duplex row house, small walk-up apartments, a live-work building type. And so those were the new elements that we added. So all the development standards for the existing ones are virtually the same as your current zoning districts, and then these are the new things that we are enabling. And then what we were able to do from there was to look at where do we want to focus those new, again, to do as little disrupting to your current zoning and current standards. And so we focused on the R4 district, one, because it was the one whose intent statement seemed to match this idea of a mix of housing types the most. It was the condominium district before, but it allowed only one type of project, a condominium, and it didn't do that well. And then the other reason was it wasn't mapped anywhere, or if it was only one place in the community where that was mapped. And so we thought that's the district where we can introduce all these new ideas and it won't affect anything that's already currently zoned. And then from that point, some of them were expanded to the R5 district, your highest density district, simply because it made sense. And again, all of the most used districts throughout the community, the R1 through 3 predominantly, didn't significantly change. So we took that approach to the non-residential development standards, again, with the idea of the economic development strategy and your comprehensive plan talking for more people-oriented places. Development codes often don't do that well if they're based just on setbacks and that's it. There's no relation of the buildings to the street, and in fact, they're actually requiring you to not relate to the street. So other than your downtown, that's what all of your zoning districts did. And so we wanted to take a more building type approach to that as well so that we could fit things in where they belonged best. And in fact, in your downtown, the risk was you could do the things that people value in and around downtown, but you weren't requiring it by any means. and there was nothing in there to regulate the scale of these buildings. A lot of times downtown zoning for communities that just adopt a zoning district assume, well, it's downtown, we want as much as possible, and so there was no building heights and things like that, and so, you know, your downtown was at risk for things that would be dramatically out of scale with it. So that was some of the things that we fixed with that regard. Similar to the residential, all of the existing building types are currently enabled. The development standards virtually match in the small commercial pad site or the general commercial and large commercial. Those development standards match what the most appropriate zoning district for that category has previously or currently. So what we really enabled were the more compact, walkable building patterns, things that might have a closer relationship to the streetscape, things that might develop more of the lot without open space as much, and so we could target those to the mixed-use centers and mixed-use zoning districts. And so what that enables to do, to again, looking at your zoning map, the CO and COA are the least mapped zoning districts in your community. There's very few places where they exist, and those seem to be the ones that most closely represented some of the new growth areas and new community commercial centers in your comprehensive plan. And then the C1, the downtown district as well, some of the things that we mentioned enabling the appropriate scale building types for those districts. And then what that left was most of the most used districts, C2, C3, M1, and M2, are virtually not changed regarding to development standards, the building scale and building setback and those types of things. The last element of this that is new is then once we have the building types, focusing on frontage types. And again, this is kind of ties into the open and civic space element, that idea of, well, zoning standards just say X percent of open space. And so what we tried to do is then say, well, let's focus the design portion of that of how buildings and sites relate to the streetscape. So we came up with 6, and then we expanded it to 7 frontage types to work with and looked at prototypes throughout communities that do things. But basically what we then do is pin which frontage type is appropriate on which type of street. So it's that merging of private investment and public investment to kind of create a more cohesive environment. And so this table reflects that and tells you kind of which puzzle pieces to put together when you're looking at development. The non-residential frontage types we talked about were buffers and edges, things that were you're separating things from adjacent sites. Then all the other ones were things that we're looking at improving the relationship of the buildings to the public realm. On the residential side, we had a similar kind of context-based approach to things that are things where you're separating to things where you're actually trying to relate things closer in a more compact setting. Here's just a few examples of each of those types throughout the community, not necessarily Gardner, but in around all of the southern Johnson County area. Buffer and edge is the more typical way to deal with the larger scale garden apartment projects. Just a typical suburban frontage on a conventional subdivision, to then the new types that we started to add. So we were in the housing types, we were enabling some of those smaller and compact houses. Well, then it becomes more important to talk about where's the driveway, how does that site relate to that streetscape, because you're going to have more and more of those on the narrower lots, and the impact of that over a course of repetitive lots was important. This is one of the ones we talked about, I think maybe a month ago, when we were discussing the limits on garages and driveways. Well, that caused us to create a whole different frontage type to give you a better idea on, you know, there's going to be some areas where you don't want to limit that, and it's not part of that context. There could be new neighborhoods or even some of your existing areas in and around downtown where you do want some of those limits that talk about some restraint on garage and driveway placement because the houses are so compact and repetitive over time. This is also something that we talked about with the residential developers in our advisory committee as well, kind of giving them a different set of kit of parts to do things a little bit differently. And then lastly, getting into more areas where you do different building types, multifamily types, but they have a real close relationship to the street. Again, not appropriate in all areas, but something that should be considered in downtown or some of the more mixed-use neighborhoods. Or arranging buildings completely differently so they front on the civic spaces rather than just on the streets. So basically what happened with those the frontage types is all of the current approaches are maintained. In other words, that idea of most of our standards are based on setbacks and then we landscape around it, that's currently maintained. Or the idea that our typical neighborhood frontage is just based on a 30-foot setback and we don't have any other standards how it relates to the streetscape. Those things can continue to happen with the current with the standards that we put in for those frontage types. What we've enabled new is to add the ones that have a higher urban design element to it, and the trade-off there is they're doing more compact development where they're trying to fit more things into a smaller area, and so those standards become more important. So it's sort of raising the bar for how the building relates to different streets and streetscapes. And again, the streets are going to set the context for what you do when and where. The last thing, and then just open it up to all kinds of questions that you want. The other things that we incorporated and fixed, Article 6 is special districts. We took a new, as I mentioned before, we took a new approach to the plan districts, so that kind of coordinates with Article 3 there. And we also coordinated with, we took a similar approach to the manufactured home park, allowing it to be more master planned with some of these neighborhood amenities and kind of to tie into some of those standards that we put in. It seemed to be an easy fit with your current manufactured home park district, so converting that to a planned district. And then coordinating with the county airport review, the current airport overlay district is, we tried to roll it in as is, but it had all kinds of conflicts in it, and so through discussions with staff and the county staff, we just dramatically streamlined it to what the county is currently doing is just getting notice of development applications in that airport overlay district and commenting on them. So we did that, and it may be a placeholder for if the county and city ever do some more detailed joint standards, but currently there weren't any being enforced in that area. Site and landscape standards, all of the current standards for buffer and landscape are incorporated in here. They're reorganized a bit and converted to tables with some updates and improvements. Mainly one of the improvements we did make was getting an upgraded tree species and plant species list that's more appropriate for this region, and talking with Parks and Rec, there were some trees on there that they wished weren't on the list, and so a landscape architect in our office has a very good list that's incorporated in the appendix, and so we're recommended to use that. And then again, keeping all the things about buffering and screening and doing that when necessary, but not making that the only strategy for how we do site design. Access and parking, again, building off the public realm design standards of Articles 4 and 7, how you access the sites and different strategies for different contexts, incorporating the current parking requirements into an easier to interpret table, but then adding flexibility for when, with some real clear criteria on when do you want to accept less parking or give credits for certain things that let you whittle down that parking count if you're in a context where it's appropriate. And then the last big one were the sign standards. We simplified those into a common set of sign types and then allowed a menu of sign or an allowance to be based on that menu of sign types and scaled those to the scale of the site and building. And then we went through and removed all the sign types that were more content-based. It's kind of tricky to do, but those things are always lurking in your ordinance. And so a lot of your recent amendments with temporary signs kind of helped us and guided us. And so those are all rolled into the new code as well. And with that, that's a quick summary. And I'd be open to any questions and discussion or wait for after public comment as well.
Yeah, I think we'll go ahead and open the public hearing. Thanks, by the way, Chris. Appreciate it. We'll now open the public hearing. If anyone would like to comment on this item, please come forward and state your name and address for the public record. Individuals will be allotted 3 minutes, or an individual representing a group will be allotted 7 minutes. With no one coming forward,
I move that we close the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion to close the public hearing made by Lovella with a second by Freeman. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries with all in favor. This is now time for a... Oh, hi, yes. Come on back up.
I got back and saw my notes. I left out one thing on the our discussion with Public Works today, kind of in the area of cleanup items coming out of this, they had some specific things that they wanted us to incorporate in the code, and there's just five punch list items that they wanted cleaned up, and just to let you guys know. The first was in section 401C3 on the street cross sections, and it's page 4.4 through 4.10. In our table, we use the term design speed, and they suggested we change that because that has a specific engineering, it's a term of art, and when we had discussion of what we were after, they thought it maybe something like targeted speed or desired speed would be better to give it that planning policy context for when you use the appropriate street section. So we're going to go ahead and make that change throughout. In that same section on page 4.8, they did say that the arterial standard street section, their current specifications require a median on that street because it is a higher speed street. And so we have that as an option. We're going to go ahead and add that in as required on that street type. Section 403B3 on drainage, that's page 419. In that section, they wanted us to remove the second sentence that talks about avoiding, it's more of a guideline type language, but it suggested avoiding drainage that goes across lots or to the rear and through the side, and they said that's actually currently preferred, and it's a current standard in your current regulations is why it's in there. We were just simply rolling it over, and they wanted to take the opportunity to change that because it doesn't really match the strategies they're using on drainage, and they thought removing that second sentence wouldn't change the substance of that section. Similarly, in 404E, storm drainage, the last sentence should read standards of the city, not standards of the city engineer. The city engineer didn't want to look like he was the king of all standards, and appropriately so. And then last one, 404F, where we coordinate with the street cross sections on utility location. We have language in there that says in the street sections in general, that just says the city engineer makes the determination on all of them. But they wanted us to also reiterate it in 404F and make it clear that the city engineer makes the final call on utility locations.
Great. Thank you. Any questions or comments from the commissioners?
Yeah.
You do have questions?
Yes, I do.
Okay, Brad, what's your question?
Well, first off, thank you, Chris, for all the work you've done on this so far. I do think that the new standard is, in general, it's cleaner, it's easier to follow, and it does eliminate a lot of redundancy. There's definitely some things in there that are changes, and they'll take some getting used to, but they're not bad things. So I do have a few or several questions or comments that we can flip through. Some of them are pretty easy. Some of them maybe I just didn't remember from our meetings. I guess I'll dive into them. 1.06C1, page 1-11. Second sentence, where it says other rehabilitation expansions may occur. Should that be other rehabilitation or expansions may occur? I'm not sure what a rehabilitation expansion is. Yeah. Oh, okay. 1.06C1 on page 1-11, second sentence, other rehabilitation expansions may occur. I believe that should be other rehabilitation or expansions may occur. Would match the first sentence. On 3.01B4, page 3-2, where it says the steps and benchmarks in the application process including all of those things. It's in the list of things that the director can change. I believe our discussions were that those should be the non-statutory steps and benchmarks, because if they're statutory, the director doesn't have the ability to change those things.
Yeah, I thought we had addressed that in Exhibit 1 by saying that regular means and means by comply with all legal requirements of notice, but that's what we thought we had addressed it.
We're in item one. Will we see that, Chris?
301B1, date of regular meeting of the UDI decision makers that comply with all legal requirements for notice of public meetings. So anything the director is doing is going to be guided by the staff.
I think so, yes. On C, in that same section, 3.01C2, procedure and submittal requirements application, I believe that should be for the application. Yeah, procedure and submittal requirements for the application, or on the application. J on page 3-5. It's the second sentence. The director of competition by applicant may permit a refiling of the application no sooner than 180 days after the scheduled review date when it determines that significant physical, economic, or land use changes have taken place. I believe it should be he or she, because it's referring to the director, if I read it correctly. Yeah, or it is, when it is determined, instead of it determined.
Mm-hmm.
3.02B2, this is on platting. The preliminary plats are larger divisions of land with new ownership and development patterns. It doesn't have to be new ownership, does it?
Or are you covered in the or statement? I don't know.
No, that is probably just more proper to say that enables, just in the concern there that one plat is now ownership can be fractured and involve the opportunity to deal with one.
Okay. C4, page 3-6. Very last sentence, should that be processed through the preliminary and final plat process? Or is it, maybe it's correct with this? Okay. Yeah, because we talk about the administrative plat process, and then any further times that it has to be replatted, it has to go through the preliminary and final plat process. Still in the same section. 3.02FB, the construction plans for any utilities, infrastructure, and public utilities meet all the technical specifications. Construction plans aren't submitted with plats in the engineering and construction world. Construction plans have a level of definition, a level of detail associated with them that I, at least I'm not used to seeing on plats. Because that would be plans and profiles and well, and that, and maybe we're just not seeing what we should be seeing in that process. If the intent is to ensure that they're going to construct those utilities to the city's specifications, which have things associated with them like bedding material and depth of cover and things of that nature, then construction documents is the correct terminology. We just don't, I haven't ever seen them in the time that I've been on the board in any of our plats. So.
Yeah, and so the point, I think the intent is you all may not, but the city engineer maybe should. So I don't know, I want to get it to work, whatever your current practices are. So we'll check with them to see if, are they reviewing and signing off before you get here.
That does seem like it would be highly detailed information for us. Like it may need to go through that process and confirmed with them first before it gets here.
And again, we'll make sure it reflects your current practices, but what we're used to is either that somewhere along the line at the final plat, someone has either seen that they've done enough engineering work that's going to be done with the specifications or actually seen the specifications showing that.
Okay.
Because the idea of this, the preliminary and final plat, that transition period is where the applicant has
enough assurances to go out this is where we talk about administrative adjustments, and number three appears to allow an administrative adjustment when to deviate from the design standard where alternative equal or better standard is proposed by the applicant. And I think in a lot of instances that's probably okay. However, also feel like equal or better can be somewhat subjective, which may be better approved by the Planning Commission. Do you guys have any thoughts on that?
I could
you're go
saying
either it's
way.
Too
subjective? Yeah,
it's too subjective.
Yeah. Is that what you're saying, Brad?
Yeah, basically, it's, I mean, yeah.
I think you have to leave a little bit, or everything has to come here. You have to leave them some decision-making tools, or it slows the process down too much on those sort of items in the process. They have to have the ability to make a decision like that. And if at some point it's determined they aren't protecting our best interest, then there's ways to enforce that in different or make recommendations on ways that that should be done. So I don't have an issue with doing that because I don't want all of that to have to come here because that will slow the process down tremendously.
Okay. Works for me. I just wanted to raise that question. Page 4-15, table 4-6. I believe the R4 district got left off. I think in the last draft there was two R5 districts, so one of them got deleted, and one of them should have been R4, would be my guess. Page 4-19, 4.03B1, there's a reference to Appendix 4-A, which I couldn't find. 4.03B1 on page 4-19. About the middle of the paragraph, it references Appendix 4-A, which I couldn't find. Don't know if that's the appendix.
I think they meant A4, possibly. Might have just been transposed.
Is it Appendix B?
Hey, Brad, I'm going to stop you real quick and just ask a question, just in essence of time. I want to ask staff for clarification here, too, if this is something we can do, because Brad is bringing up some, there's a couple of good, you know, hey, I'd like to discuss this with the commission on some changes. But he's also bringing up, just like that one, you know, typographical and, you know, wording changes. And, Brad, this is totally up to you. I don't want to steal your time because we have plenty of time. But I know you comb this with a fine-tooth comb, which is fantastic. But would it be appropriate if there's typographical type of issues? Because I know that's a part of the possible, you know, recommended motion. If we can amend the motion, you know, if there's any way in which that Brad could submit those types of things to say, hey, make sure you catch this to staff, and just we could focus on the ones that you've brought up, like that administrative, or the one we just covered, where, you know, do we want to allow the administration that much authority? I don't know if this needs to be on public record to where he needs to speak to each one, or if he could send an email to staff and, you know, but just
like
with
that one, I didn't see this.
Yeah,
is that correct?
Like, yeah, I didn't see that table, or, you know, I think the sentence should be read this way. And just maybe we could focus on the ones that, just like you read, you know, what do you guys think as a commission, would this be appropriate? Would that be okay for our meeting tonight? Because I know we do have, as a potential, you know, motion that we are calling out, there is going to be those types of changes. It's totally, you know, I want to make sure we're doing the right thing.
A detailed list of what those are.
Okay.
And if I don't know, perhaps there's, you know, the rest of the commissioners would like the opportunity to do the same thing.
I'm very grateful that
you. I agree.
I am too.
Completely agree. Yeah, because I want to make sure it's good and to the point. And if you're completely fine with that, Brad, I don't want to steal your time because we do have time.
Yeah. No, I'm fine with that. We can talk through any of them that are more substantive changes rather than wording and references and things of that nature.
Okay. Thank you.
And then we can make a decision at the end if it's too much that needs to change to approve or
okay.
what we want to do.
Yeah, yeah.
So with that, we can jump to table 5-2 on the use table. Page 5-7. I guess I was confused to see multi-unit household living in the CO, COA, and C1 districts. What was the, I guess, what's the reasoning behind that? I want to say that was, I can't remember if it changed or not. But
that actually parallels Article 7 on the building type, so that's the use, annual use typically on the building type in Article 7 that were allowed in those districts.
Wasn't that kind of along the line of having those, I don't know, like, almost the,
So, row houses, walk-up apartments, and, mixed-use and the live-work building types were all allowed,
right.
And they just added those districts, allowed them to be more reduced environments, so that's why that use has been able to reflect those buildings that we built.
Okay, and I...
That's on...
Right, which is another comment that I would have gotten to when I got to Section 7. It doesn't make sense to me intuitively that row houses and walk-up apartments fit within those districts. I'm not a planning expert, so maybe they do. I believe that differed from the last draft that we saw, and so it jumped out at me. True. Conversely, we don't allow commercial in the residential areas.
Yeah, the mixed use.
I think if you refer back to page 5-2 where it talks specifically about the uses for those districts, it offers a pretty good explanation of why that's appropriate, of why some of those types of homes might be complemented by some of these types of businesses that could be available there, whether it be the retail. You know, you can think in some areas, urban areas, whether it's the bodega on the corner with a series of row houses, all those things of that nature would complement that, even if it's offices. So I think when you look at this table and then compare it back to that page 5-2, they seem to overlap and make sense to me as I read those of why that's an appropriate use of those. And what those districts are and what they entail. So I think it's appropriate the way it's listed on the table now.
Kind of like what they build in Leawood, like at the Town Center Plaza, where there's apartments along with your retail and your...
Right, within the same city block.
It's all in the same, mm-hmm. Exactly.
Okay.
I'd like to leave that.
So it hits with mixed use
mm-hmm.
feasibilities.
Okay. Was there a reason that we, table 5-2, page 5-8, daycare centers, zone R3 or RE is excluded or doesn't have a conditional use opportunity on it. I didn't know why we wouldn't want them in RE. Daycare center.
Well,
wouldn't it be, because a daycare center, there would be a lot of traffic involved in that, and I mean, would you want that in the estate
type of area?
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't.
Well, then I think that also lends itself that if it's a daycare center,
mm-hmm.
that someone would have to build that facility within the residential estate, which would probably be prohibited as
yeah.
part of the estate regulation. Because
mm-hmm.
if I understand the residential estates, these are large lots that will be specifically used and limited to residential uses. The way I'm reading the description and understand it to be.
The other logic behind it, whether it's right or not, again, it's a conditional review, so you have some further discretion to decide or not, but the planning logic behind it is we're trying to get keep it, those districts predominantly, if not exclusively, residential, but allow some neighborhood supporting and that young the estate and the lowest of they don't have a critical mass there and they want the center to begin with, but it doesn't need that support and the craft that was there is probably supporting a much broader area because of the
so
maybe more grass associated. I that was a lot behind the right
sure.
or
wrong. Mm-hmm. And that makes sense. I appreciate that explanation. It clarifies it for me. I'll keep going, but apologize that I didn't read back to those types of things more closely. On the healthcare large, page 5-9, we allow healthcare small and healthcare general in the M1 district, but we don't allow healthcare large.
In which district?
M1.
M1.
Well, if you look at the M1, and again, the way it states, it's uses that do not require intensive land coverage, generate large volumes of vehicular traffic, probably are the two biggest ones, I would think. There, a large healthcare center is going to generate a pretty substantial amount of traffic, and the large land coverage from a parking standpoint, you think of the health centers that they're building, so seems to be pretty appropriate again there.
Lodging, bed and breakfast. We allow it in COA and C1, but not CO. CO is the office district. COA is the neighborhood business district.
Probably not going to have a bed and breakfast in an office.
Right.
An office.
Again, office district compared to small scale retail, where bed and breakfast is a better complement. I think it needs to be left the way that it is.
I agree.
Short-term rental detached houses we don't allow in ag. That's fine.
Which one?
Sorry, which one did
which
you say,
one?
Brad?
The lodging short-term rental detached house. We allowed an RE, R1, R2, but not ag.
It's a, I mean,
short-term rental, so that would be like...
Like an Airbnb type thing.
Yeah.
I guess I didn't think of a reason why to exclude that zone, but I also don't know that it's a...
Is there a reason why not?
Demand.
Right, but do we envision having that sort of getaway within the city limits and annexed land?
No.
That's most times going to be in county and rural settings.
Yeah.
And not the agricultural lands that are set within the city. And it's not the same as a rental home or something of that nature. The business is completely different.
I can go either way on that one.
It doesn't bother me either way. I'm fine with it as is.
I'm comfortable leaving it the way it is as well.
Okay. Office limited and, or wait, not limited. Office general is not allowed in the office district. CO or COA.
From a size perspective, it wouldn't complement those areas.
Yeah, you're getting a little out of scale with neighbors.
Right. Plus square feet
mm-hmm.
in a residential district or a complementary district would create issues, I think. I think that actually makes quite a bit of sense.
Yeah, I agree too. It just seems counterintuitive, again, that your offices aren't allowed in your office district.
Well, they are, just not that big.
Right.
Right.
Within the limits of said district. Wonderfully illustrated in the table.
Commercial storage, outdoor, minor. We do allow that in the C3 district. We don't allow any indoor storage. Or major storage, but we do allow commercial storage outdoor in that C3. I guess I wasn't sure that commercial outdoor storage was a good fit for C3, but I've been wrong many times.
What's considered minor?
Consumer products or small scale commercial products on an outdoor lot. Examples include contractor's yard or a similar facility where products used in other small business operations
are stored for distribution. So that would be maybe someone that would own a landscaping business and they'd need to store their equipment
stuff
and
outside,
manage it. So short-term storage options to really facilitate their business.
Sorry, I didn't have these. Page 5-35, section T. Number actually, I kind of remember talking about that one. Number two, I was asking if we really needed paved roads to all of the wells.
I think within the city limits,
yeah,
it's something we should encourage from a dust perspective and other.
I do kind of remember talking about that one. On page 5-36, W2, just 2 in general. I know the last edition that we saw had a requirement for towers over a certain height to leave room for another carrier on that tower. That provision has been removed in this draft. The reasoning behind that change. It seemed, I guess it's not necessarily something we need to regulate in the standard. It's just a way to limit the number of towers they're going to need around the city. Yeah, and I know this section kind of got reformatted a little, so it may have just been overlooked somehow. Table 7-2, page 7-5. Building types has an asterisk next to it. And a couple of the interior side distances have asterisks next to them. Did I miss where those are referenced back to? I couldn't find it. Just want to make sure there's nothing. It could be grammatical, it could be substantial. intent if we're missing a part. On walk-up apartment and mid-rise apartment, on the interior side, setback distance is the 10 feet. Section 2D. D as in dog. This is where we talk about the transition of the materials at the interior corners or at the trim line. I know I wasn't at the meeting when you guys talked about this, and I think you did discuss it about it, not wanting the building to seem flat. I also know that this is a specific point that we discussed in the advisory committee meetings from all of the developers and has been something that we've had to deal with as a planning commission before. And I also know that my house doesn't comply with it, which I didn't build. But I just still question whether we shouldn't have some provision to wrap an exterior corner or stop at an outside corner, or something other than just the interior corner of the trim line, based on the feedback that we've received in those various meetings.
Do you think it should include exterior corners also?
Either an outside corner or I think what we have allowed recently has been a wrap of 18 inches or 24 inches or something like that. I don't necessarily have a problem with an outside corner as long as, and like it says, there's a trim line there for the transition, but how you define what that trim line is, maybe that's the route, is they put a trim line along the outside edge to make that transition.
Is that where it gives us the opportunity for those things to come back for review, and then we can make exceptions where that's necessary? I mean, if we add more to it, then that limits those chances for us to review that. And I'll be frank, I don't know that I understand all of the different ways that it can wrap and what's the appropriate amount that should be done. So I'd be more comfortable in seeing that in the applications and addressing it on that basis. Because if we have... If we make it too wide, then it allows those things, but then we lose some of our ability to make decisions when necessary.
Right, and I agree with that point. I also remember some of the discussions. I think it was during the advisory committee meetings where the developers talked about they see a standard like that, and it says you have to wrap it in an interior corner, and so none of those houses get rock on them because they can't, yeah, because they can't do it somewhere else, and they don't want to come to the planning commission, and so then, I mean, I don't know the right answer.
Do we need to consider, if we read it in the inverse way, it's the end of that sentence is where the change is emphasizing different structural bays for a building.
Right, and maybe it could be interpreted.
Right. Does it not have to be interior corners of the trim line where the change is not emphasizing different structural bays? Then is it, does that cover it? Does that make sense? Am I stating that okay? Just reading that whole sentence through. So the transition between materials maybe should not have to occur at interior corners if the change is not emphasizing different structural bases. Just kind of invert everything. Then does that cover it?
No, I see what you're saying.
Well, the other,
going back to
I mean,
points
what,
being let, allowing ambiguity.
It's got it built in. I mean, what's emphasizing different structural base and what qualifies as a structural base? So there's interpretation already built into it from the language itself. Mm-hmm. So they could look at that and change in the middle and test what the definition of a structural bay is, and we could have some, the language allows us to interpret that. Mm-hmm. And even, not us, I think that would allow staff to do so as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Are we done with that one?
Yeah, I think I'd be okay with 2D as is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I just see a typo. Up on number one, it's C and E instead of CB. Under C1.
Mm. We're not addressing those right now.
I know. Sorry. I just wanted to speak. I'm just kidding. Go on, Brad.
You had that one marked.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you did.
I did not. No, I just marked it.
We do appreciate your fine-tooth comb, by the way.
Absolutely.
Not nothing.
Absolutely.
Not joking
yes.
at all. It is appreciated.
Yes.
D, page 7-10, is number 4 on the color palette. A. The way that I read this, it appeared as though your development could have the same primary and accent colors for all of the buildings. I know our current standards require 5 variations. I didn't see anything about 5 variations in the standards, and I have some concern about large housing developments with all of the buildings being the exact same color. I don't think that's desirable. No, I mean 5 different colors within a housing development over a certain size, I think is what the current regulations talk about.
Was that colors or was that like not building types? What am I saying? Like facades or something?
You have to have 5
differences.
A design standard?
Yeah.
I guess the real question to the board is, does anyone else have a concern with the whole development being the same color?
I don't, yeah. I mean, I'd like to see some difference in the houses. As long as they're all kind of within the same palette.
Right.
Yeah.
I don't. I understand the concern. I really don't think our odds of a developer coming in and painting all of his homes the same color are high enough to be worrisome. I can't imagine any developer coming in and doing that. And painting them all, and maybe that's naive, but I can't think of an example where I've ever seen that, and somebody try to force that issue.
Yeah,
I guess I can't cite where it was. I'm fairly certain that I have seen it. I don't know that it was in Gardner, but no, not the standard. The actual development with all the buildings being the same color, and. I guess my take on it is if we don't have that provision and someone does do it, we have no recourse to prevent it.
I'd have to know if we had that in place before and what is the proper dynamics. Is it 5 different colors if there's 20 homes, or what are the ratios of where that sort of would come into to be applied?
Also seeing that, kind of thinking through that theoretical builder coming in and painting all the houses one or two colors, would that have a lot of people flocking to that area?
Nope.
No.
That's why I didn't think it would be something that would happen.
And also thinking that through, if the builder's plans, would they come before the planning commission with
yeah,
with possible colors, and
so
if we see
no building
them looking
be
the same
until a color palette has been approved by the planning commission.
I mean,
so
wouldn't that kind of see it through? We would,
right.
It would have catches kind of built
mm-hmm.
in. I think I'm okay with 4A.
I am.
Sticking as is.
Yep.
Flipping pages now. Page 8 dash, well, maybe that's, I'll ask it. Page 8 dash 2, section 8.03, table 8 dash 1, non-residential districts, we require foundation plantings of large trees, large or medium trees, every 40 linear feet along the foundation. And I know the foundation planting is within 8 feet of the building or 8 feet of the foundation. Large trees grow to, what was the definition, over 40 feet, I think. And maybe this is something your landscape folks have commented on. Is it not concerning to have large trees within 8 feet of building foundations? Page 8-5, 8.04A, either A or B, kind of wrote the note over both of them. No, it's A5, where we exclude your delivery and vehicle bays, vehicle service bays, except bays. Do not need to be screened from adjacent property with the same or more intense zoning. Maybe I read that wrong. Does
I think
this
that's just a typo, or isn't it? Except that
I guess my concern is that we're prohibiting someone like a Quick Lube from building on, well, anywhere. If we require them to screen their service bays from all streets, I don't think I've seen one of those type of places that doesn't have their service base facing the street. I agree with not having them on certain types of streets.
But in those cases, those would be bays that do not need to be screened from adjacent property because it's the same or more intense zoning. That it's an adjacent property, it's already in a district that's zoned for that sort of commercial use or more so.
Yeah, that was the part that I was just Okay, so it doesn't actually talk about streets now. Disregard. Sorry. And I could ask this question separately, but on 8.04 B4B on page 86. Sorry. B3D4B on page 86. We limit chain link and vinyl clad chain link on M1 and M2 districts no closer than 30 feet from any public street. And I was just curious as to the reasoning for that prohibition.
I think that's a sound policy because we don't want those screen fencing being so close to the roadside and being so prominently displayed because it's not as clean as a finish in most cases. This has a, in essence, establishes a setback to make sure it's not the visual focus of the front facade of those facilities. That's how I read it and what would be the justification from my standpoint.
I would agree.
Basically, it doesn't screen as well as the other ones, and so we need some distance as well as the screening that it provides for those two districts.
I see it more as an aesthetic purpose more than the screening itself, but...
To push it back further from
right.
The street, mm-hmm. I'd agree.
Well, something like chain link doesn't really screen. I mean, it divides, it sets a boundary, but
right.
You kind of see right through
maybe
it.
Maybe that's why, I mean...
What it's meant to do, you don't, you know...
If it's just there for a boundary, then mm-hmm. It can be further back, so it doesn't look good.
And rear and side only.
Well, that, yeah, it can be used as screening, especially when they put the slat systems in it, but
mm-hmm.
This is why we don't want that to be the front-facing aesthetic in those districts.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Or someone that has just a screened gate on that front side, it needs to be a gate that's a more prominent feature. So I think that's definitely the way we want to go there, for me.
I agree.
Agreed.
Right.
Yep.
I think I missed the discussion that we had on the flags, so now I'm on page 10-2, 10.02C flags, where we limit them to 3 non-commercial flags per lot. We have existing city lots with 4 flags on them. What was the and I just can't remember the discussion. I missed that meeting. I watched it, but I can't remember the discussion.
So what's your question? Why are we limiting?
It is, yeah, I guess it's 3 the right number if we already have non-compliant city lots that as soon as we adopt this are in non-compliance. Or do we need to take one of the flags down at Veterans Park?
Thank you.
think, yeah, that's exactly the discussion.
Yep, you're right.
Is there's exemption through permit.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's all right.
That clarifies for me. Is there any, and that raises another question, I don't have a reference to it. Do we ever define that permit process?
No. Would the permitting process be in
the
code?
Yeah, signs being.
It's like a separate process.
Requiring permits, being exempt from permits. The temporary signs exemption from permits. But I don't recall seeing anywhere that we actually talk about a permit process or establish one or a requirement to get them.
Well, we already have a permit process in place just through city staff, the traditional permit process and what we go. I don't know that that would be something that'd be addressed in the land code.
No.
So that's a process more than a code.
Now, I guess if that section requires them to have a permit, and then what that permitting process entails is outside the scope of this document, it sounds like. So, okay, that clarifies that for me.
Right.
Yeah.
This is a question on the pole-mounted signs or the freestanding signs where we have the exception within 1,000 feet of an interstate. The pole sign may be up to 70 feet high and a maximum of 300 square feet. I don't necessarily envision seeing this happen, but I also know that I can't foresee everything that's ever going to happen. Do we need to include anything in there that says that the sign actually has to face the interstate or be visible from the interstate? Because you could be within 1,000 feet of the interstate and be blocked by a building or something else. But this says you can have a gigantic billboard.
Well, I think you have to avoid that because there's going to be circumstances where one side of the interstate may have vision of that side, but the other side won't. So how do you clarify which? If you're going southbound, you're going to see a sign, but if you're going northbound, you won't on the interstate. So I don't think you want to include that sort of language in there.
Well, either direction you're traveling, you're still on the interstate. So it's
right,
visible from the interstate.
Well, you're still going to see the back of it.
But what if it's visible from one side and not the other, just because the directions you're heading or the way the sign faces?
That'd be fine. But what if it's blocked by a building and faces towards the housing district or towards the commercial district or is on the front side of their building that is adjacent to the interstate, and so you can't really see the sign from the interstate? I don't know. I don't envision this happening.
I guess I'm trying to visualize the circumstance where it would be an issue. If they're within 1,000 feet of the interstate and they want that height to go up to it, it seems appropriate.
I'm okay with it as it is.
Page 10-6. I know this was discussed at the meeting as well, and I apologize that I don't remember the outcome of the discussion. Garage sale signs, fundraiser signs, where we're prohibiting any sign with a commercial message has to be located on the site of the commercial activity?
Well, I think that's where we talked about your commercial activity is business operations, not those fundraisers, bazaars, garage sales type things. I think this is geared towards business A, advertising on the front lot of business B, and limiting them from doing so, not limiting your charitable organizations or anything else. That's the commercial standard for that.
Okay. So do we need to define commercial activity somewhere since...
I don't think we want to define it. I think we want to have the opportunity for interpretation if necessary. Because if you try to define it to too much detail, then you've got a better chance of leaving something out and leaving it open rather than leaving it vague and open to that and going to that.
And I tend to agree, but if you think the standard definition of commercial, it leads to sales, which is a garage sale.
But I don't think, I don't see a garage sale as being a commercial
entity by any means.
It's right, an entity. That's a good word to use. And I'd rather leave it more vague as well, the interpretation.
Can you offer a different way to look at that other than garage sale example? I think they're leaning more towards a temporary sign kind of view for garage sales.
Right, and I agree we don't want business A from advertising in front of business B, so I agree that's a good standard. I just don't want to prohibit garage sales, fundraisers, and school.
Well, at the end of the day, you're going to prohibit through enforcement.
Mm-hmm.
So if we don't have people that are directed to enforce garage sale signage as commercial signage, we won't have a problem.
Yeah, and I have a problem with that too.
Yeah.
I don't want to write a standard that we're not going to enforce. Don't know if can we add the word entity in there somewhere or somehow clarify the intent of 11.
Are you suggesting maybe just change commercial activity to commercial entity so we focus more on the space, not the what?
That would be, yeah.
That would help, I think.
But then again, you could still say an entity is a garage sale.
Yeah.
I mean, I just don't interpret it that way.
Yeah. If you really want to get in the weeds with it, you could change it to any sign with a business message shall be located on the side of the business activity. I don't think many people are going to try to clarify a charitable organization or garage sale as a business.
Right. I would agree with that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That'll do it then.
Thank you, Heath. Yeah, I like that.
Okay.
Let's reword it.
So we'd like to change commercial to business, please.
Electronic message signs, page 10-7, section 10.06, C1. We're limiting the electronic message signs to the C2, C3, M1, and M2 districts, which in general I understand the intent behind that when you're thinking of new, bright, big electronic message signs. However, what used to be Metcalf Bank and that pharmacy across the road both have electronic message signs on them that, to me, don't detract from anything. So, again, I don't know if prohibiting the C1 district.
Is
the right...
Was there a reason
for that? But then...
read that following sentence, or for permitted institutional or civic use in all other districts, so it becomes a permit issue, so that way it's looked at differently, you know, in a C1 or any other, at least that's how I'm reading it, in any other district. So you're kind of covering yourself there, saying, hey, you know, the intensity of the C2, 3, M1, and M2, say, yep, you can go ahead and do it, but for any other district, we want a permit.
Apply for the permit.
So we want to take a look at it deeper and see what is around it. You know, it could be impacting.
Yeah, but it says permitted institutional or civic use.
Well, I would view
city and school.
That's what I think of when I hear that, so.
Banking institution. I mean, institutional is a pretty vague.
Institutions.
Is that vague enough?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Okay.
I just seem it,
yeah. That's good.
It would focus on other districts versus what it is.
Are we considering striking institutional or civic?
No, just leave it as is.
Yeah, just leave it. Because if that's, you know, broad enough to cover, like those guys over there, then
mm-hmm.
I say leave it in.
Yeah.
And is the, I guess, just to clarify with Chris, is the intent of that permitted, meaning specifically permitted somewhere else in the standard, or applying for a permit for that sign?
It's applying for
permitted
a permit,
use. Well, could we then strike institutional or civic and just say, or for a permitted use in all other districts?
That'd be fine with me.
Okay.
Okay.
Cool. No.
If they have to apply
yeah.
for a permit, are they going to get
a
one?
A permit could be denied. I mean,
see,
you have to have a standard of what denies that.
That's the other question that I had was, is it permitted use or is it a use that requires a permit? Is the use permitted to happen or do you
have well,
to
could
have
it just be changed to limited to those districts or by conditional use permit?
The origin of that statement is to recognize that schools and
right.
churches often have these types of signs that they have a more public
message to deliver.
So they're often in residential districts, but don't want to be able to contact in one residential district.
Okay, so what if then we add C1 to that and leave it like it is? I mean, because it's going to have to be approved, whatever signage they have, correct?
Set a precedent.
And maybe we don't want them to see one as a general statement.
I'd rather not. My opinion.
I think as it's written, it's fairly.
I'd agree.
The other thing to keep in mind about this is that we need to read this
Right.
Now the signs are almost like video screens.
Right.
Stuff that we technology-wise is pretty impressive. So we would be enabling that stuff as well. Subject to the static display, but they can, you know, be interviewed with the all kinds of things.
Right.
Correct. No, I agree. That's a good point. I think my only, I shouldn't say that. I always come up with more questions, but almost my last question anyway. On C4 and on D, we referenced that they can't have more than 50% of the sign area as either changeable or electronic. And I know I listened to the meeting that I missed, but I still don't understand why we limit it to 50%. I mean,
would that then become your huge, gigantic video screens if you didn't limit it?
As long as it's within the size limits of a sign.
And I think you also ran in the case by limiting it to 50%. Then it still maintains the primary business function of branding their business, the business logo, identifying the business that might not be done in each screen that's within their display or the information that's within their display. So the signage, that you would think, in essence, ensures that they're going to put their branding and logoing on there to identify the business, and that makes it the primary purpose. And if you make the signage larger, there's not a way to enforce that. We don't have anything that talks about what the message is, so it doesn't have to identify the business in any way. While this doesn't, you'd think in most cases that would be how they'd use that 50% space otherwise. So I think from a policy standpoint, it's pretty sound to have that sort of limitation in place. So it's not just one large video board that might not be identifying the business with every single display that's on it at all times, when that should be the primary purpose of the sign itself.
Yep. That makes sense. Thank you. Aside from that, I think everything else that I had found was primarily typos, grammatical, that kind of stuff. I will type those up, send them in to staff and Chris. I guess I do have, as we start thinking now about the approval process for this, I have a little concern that we're still having conversations with Public Works and Streets, and we're changing content, and none of that's finalized yet. So for us to approve something that we know is still being edited concerns me. And that's my take. If we can vote on it, I could be the only one that thinks that way. But
well, it's to what extent do we expect any changes to come from that conversation, I think, is the proper follow-up to that. If the changes are clerical, it kind of talks about non-substantiated, but if we expect that to go to a deeper thing, then Brad's absolutely right that we aren't to the final document from the trust there.
Well, he brought up a lot of things tonight that weren't, you know, all typographical or grammatical, so
but a lot
it
of
does
those,
seem that yeah. There are some things that still need to be worked out.
We didn't end up changing very many of those, though, so I'd be comfortable with what we discussed here, but the items that talked about with the Public Works Director, if there are things that are going to come from that are substantive changes, then that does make it maybe improper to vote on the document because it's not completed.
Okay.
The nature of our discussion today was those five that I read off, the 4.01.23 changes, 9 terms.
Right.
Adding the convenient, required, relevant, enabling. Standards
But those are mostly clerical items. I mean, in essence, they aren't changing anything from a substantial nature.
They aren't changing current practice at all.
No.
So when you made the statement earlier about needing to work further with the street department to align their standards with this standard, there's no chance of this standard being affected by their standards?
Yeah, so that was the other part. That was the other part of our discussion today. So we discussed at length how they're going to use the cross section and the complete streets policy guide, and they. I don't want to speak for them, but they thought it was helpful. They said, we're not there yet on getting our specifications finalized, but we could certainly use these to finalize them. And again, what we were explaining to them is the full intro to that section talks about these are the urban design. We're not trying to say this actual cross section has to be built. We're saying these are the urban design guides for how you arrive at this cross section. City engineer needs to approve the final one. And so they were in thinking about what they're going through right now in the specifications, they were seeing the chance that, well, when we get through it, because they don't know, maybe we do need to go. There is a process of changing their specifications now, so that we're going to come back to you all at some time. And so there may be some cleanup that has to come along with that when they get through it. They just weren't there yet.
So it really doesn't sound as though it's a cause for delay in any way from our perspective, because we can revise the document if necessary, and we can clean everything up if it's necessary after that process is done.
Okay. No other questions? I'd entertain a motion on this item if we're good on the questions.
I move that the Planning Commission recommends the final draft of the Gardner Land Development Code to the governing body for adoption, subject to the following conditions. That staff finalize any non-substantive formatting, graphic, and typographical issues remaining in the final draft prior to adoption or prior to the effective date of the code, and further recommends the repeal of all existing conflicting ordinances or parts of ordinances.
Second. Do we need, before we vote on this, do we need to add number 2 about the address public works corrections?
Oh.
As address, look at your screen. Okay. Number 2, that
sure.
Be incorporated. Would you mind?
I'd like to revise my motion to include item number 2, address public work corrections as discussed.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion made by Freeman with a second by Barber that the revised recommendation brought forth by Commissioner Freeman is that the Planning Commission recommends the final draft of the Gardner Land Development Code to the governing body for adoption subject to following conditions 1 and 2, and further recommends the repeal of all existing conflicting ordinances or parts of ordinances. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 All those opposed?
No.
Motion passes with, how many is there? 6? 5 in favor, 1 nay. Okay. With that, that concludes the end of our meeting tonight. I want to quickly thank Sherry Barber for her time on the commission. We will miss you. Thank you for your input.
Thank you, Sherry.
You're welcome. Well, and I'd like to thank all of you guys. It's been great. It's been a great learning experience for me. And to staff for all your hard work. I didn't realize there was so much that went into all this. But, yeah, it was good, and I appreciate all of you. So thanks.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thanks,
and with that, I would entertain a motion to adjourn for the evening.
I make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
We have a motion made by Barber with a second by Lammer that we adjourn for the evening. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? Meeting's adjourned.
Thanks again, Barbara.
Thanks
for taking the lead on that.
Absolutely.
Commissioner.
Well, and
she's
checking. guess, further clarify my nay.
You don't have to clarify. That's okay.
I know. I just fact-checked my remarks. I didn't actually read the whole thing.
Oh, yeah.
So I didn't feel like I had time to review it.
I would vote nay if I thought that.
This meeting is too bad.
Yep.
This is all just planning commission stuff. So you're talking about Brian back in. Okay.
Oh.
Did he not call, he didn't call you back?
No.
Okay. Okay.
Sure.
He's been trying to get in touch with Brian.
Yeah.
Brian doesn't.
You catch everything.
Well, the only reason I heard that is I'm trying to figure out how to do this. He knows about it. Brian knows how to think about it. Then I asked him to put some plates in on the top of it and to be sure or to protect it. You know, if I hit him, you know, I'll see him. They're not going to go away.
Right.
Very sensible request for a guy not getting back with me. I don't care how busy he is. I don't care how busy he is.
And I will pick your contact.
So you're work over here?
Yes.
So you're Brian over Brian?
No. He's the director of public works and I'm in the Hamilton County Development Department. And so I guess I would consider the city administrator to be the director.
Okay.
So that would be Sarah.
Okay. Okay. Why don't you write that down in this call, and then we'll do that. It might be wasted, you know, your time.
Well, you're not wasting your time.
But I feel strong enough that I came up here three times and asked for him to call me. You know, I've met him out there on my property several times. I mean, he's over 25, worth more than that for me never to go to my property and meet him three or four times. You know what I'm saying?
Sure. I don't know her direct line, but if you call and ask for her,
but she's
anybody
his,
can get
that's his boss.
Yes, but she's not here this week.
Okay, that's fine. This has been going on for 2 years.
Yeah,
so.
But she would be her supervisor.
Okay, sounds good. Okay.
Yeah, we have kids, well, you know,